Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box, and the timestamping for the benefit of mobile phone viewers has also been provided in the comment section. Now let us move on to the first news article. This news article is a response editorial article to the successful launch of Chandrayaan 2 spacecraft from the Earth's surface. Now the syllabus related to the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. The news article states that the second mission to Moon will further explore the Earth's natural satellite. Now this is because India has launched the first mission to Moon in October 2008. And this first mission to Moon is called as Chandrayaan 1. And Chandrayaan 2 is a sequel to the Chandrayaan 1. Here the word sequel means a follow-up or a continuation of the first Moon mission. And note that this second mission is headed by two women. And the news article is telling that it's the first Indian interplanetary mission that is being headed by two women. So when we say satellite, it is an object that moves around a larger object. If it is a natural object that moves naturally without the assistance of man, if it naturally moves around a larger object, then it is called as a natural satellite. When we say naturally here, we mean without the assistance of man. The moon is called as a natural earth satellite because it moves naturally around the earth. But if we human beings send a satellite and make it revolve around the earth, then it will be called as artificial earth satellite. This time in the second lunar mission, ISRO is attempting to soft land on the lunar surface. That too particularly in the south polar region of the moon, or it will attempt soft landing near South Pole. Earlier, we have successfully demonstrated striking the moon surface or hitting the moon surface or creating an impact in the moon surface. This was done in the first mission to moon. This particular striking project was called as Moon Impact Probe. This time for soft landing, a series of braking mechanism is required to ensure that the lander touches the moon surface softly. The author says that the presence of water was first indicated by the Moon Impact Probe carried out by Chandrayaan 1. Chandrayaan 1 has carried with itself the NASA's Moon Mineralogy Mapper. That is, one of the payload that was carried out by Chandrayaan 1 is a Moon Mineralogy Mapper from NASA. This mapper has helped in confirming the presence of water in Moon. It was found that water is locked in the minerals in Moon. So we could see that Chandrayaan 1 carrying around some 14 scientific instruments or payloads. One among them in the main satellite is Terrain Mapping Camera. This camera has mapped the Moon three-dimensionally at 5 kilometer resolution. Even in the present mission also, there is a terrain mapping camera. It is expected that this will give a better version of a 3D map. And this will be also the first time that ISRO is studying the vertical temperature gradient, the thermal conductivity of the lunar surface, and also the seismicity of the moon. So when we say a vertical temperature gradient, we mean the rate of change in temperature with respect to height in the atmosphere of moon. The author is saying that with successful mission of Chandrayaan 2, ISRO will be testing the technologies for deep space missions. Deep space mission here means any mission to the outer space with orbiter or lander or rover, any mission to moon or deeper into the outer space. According to Outer Space Treaty that is adopted by the United Nations General Assembly, outer space includes the moon and other celestial bodies. And the Chandrayaan 1 mission of India is called as India's first mission to deep space by NASA. And India's second deep space mission will be Mars Orbiter mission that was launched in the year 2013. A deep space mission is also called as interplanetary mission, according to ISRO. This mission involves a trip to the planet or other planets of our solar system outside of the Earth. It will be carried out by using satellites, lander spacecrafts, and rovers. The primary objective of a deep space mission is to demonstrate technologies relating to communication and also to demonstrate technologies with respect to surviving in deep space environments and also on the planets, and also exploration of physical, chemical, and atmospheric systems on the particular planet or planets. Yesterday, that is July 22, 2019, at 2:43 p.m., the Chandrayaan 2 has been launched from Sriharikota in Andhra Pradesh, and the launch vehicle soared into the sky, marking the beginning of the 48-day journey to soft land on the moon. The launch itself is an achievement because this is the first operational flight of the indigenously developed GSLV Mark III. Note that this launch vehicle has carried a spacecraft of weight to the level of 3.84 tons or 3,840 kilograms. So yesterday the spacecraft has been launched into the Earth orbit, which is 6,000 kilometer more than what was actually planned. So because of this, the spacecraft will have more fuel and also more life to carry on the maneuvers. So now it is revolving the Earth. In the coming days, a series of orbit maneuvers will be carried out using the propulsion system. These maneuvers will raise the orbit of the spacecraft in steps, that is step by step, and it will place the spacecraft in the lunar transfer trajectory. A trajectory is nothing but a path, a lunar transfer path. From the lunar transfer trajectory path, the spacecraft will travel close to the moon and enter the moon's sphere of influence. Then it will be captured into a preliminary orbit around the moon. From here, the spacecraft will do a series of maneuvers around the moon, and finally, the spacecraft will be circularized at 100 kilometer height from the lunar surface or the moon's surface. It is in this orbit the separation or the decoupling of lander from the orbiter will happen. Know that the lander will be having the rover inside itself. So it is expected that after the separation, the lander will attempt soft landing along with the rover inside on September 7, 2019 to make India the fourth country in the history to successfully demonstrate the soft landing on the moon. Note that earlier this year, China in its Chang'e 4 mission has soft landed on the far side of the moon. We know that the same side of the moon is always facing the Earth. So the other side of the moon is called as the far side of the moon. Coming to ISRO, see, the space activities were initiated in our country in the year 1962. This initiation happened with the setting up of Indian National Committee for Space Research. It is shortly called as INCOSPAR. This INCOSPAR later transformed into ISRO, Indian Space Research Organization, in August 1969. The Government of India constituted the Space Commission and it established Department of Space in June 1972 and then brought ISRO under this Department of Space. So with this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. These news articles are about the recent enthusiasm expressed by some of the countries for spacefaring to moon. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article have been highlighted here for your reference. The July 2019 is a special month for space history because this marks the 50th anniversary of Apollo 11 mission of July 1969. We know that Apollo 11 mission is the first manned mission to land in moon. So we could see huge enthusiasm and commercial interest for spacefaring to moon. As of now, we could see three high profile missions that are proposed. One is Chang'e 5 mission by China, then another mission by NASA to send humans again to moon by 2024, and then Chandrayaan 3. Now the Chang'e 5 mission will be the fifth mission in China's lunar mission series. Now Chang'e is a Chinese moon goddess. That's why the lunar mission series has been named after this moon goddess. This Chang'e 5 is proposed to be conducted in December 2019 by the China National Space Administration. And this also will be the first sample return mission of China, because the mission aims to bring at least 2 kilograms of lunar soil and rock samples to our Earth. Now let's see the NASA's program. This program is called as Artemis program. Now they have planned to send human beings again to Moon by the year 2024. But this time they have planned to do it with collaboration with the private companies and also with European Space Agency. Now let's see the another high profile proposed mission, that is Chandrayaan 3. Now this will be, as of now, proposed as a joint collaboration between ISRO and JAXA. JAXA is nothing but Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency. So this mission was first talked about in the Asia Pacific Regional Space Agency Forum in the year 2017. That forum was held in Bengaluru. So they are calling it as Joint Lunar Polar Exploration Mission. And again, this Chandrayaan 3 is proposed as a sample return mission. Most probably that will be experimented by 2024. Now let's see some of the commercial interests in Moon. It is believed that the lunar soil and dust are rich in helium-3. Now helium-3 is a proposed clean energy resource, and it is said that if it is possible to explore and if it can be obtained in huge levels, they could bring it back to Earth to address the energy requirement here. And this can also replace conventional polluting fossil fuels. And then they are saying that rocks in Moon contain an important mineral known as anorthite. In Earth, it is a rare mineral, but it is widely available in Moon. This anorthite could be used in construction, and they are saying it could form the backbone of lunar manufacturing industry. Now see, in future, there will be some space station or some establishments in the Moon also. So they are saying that this anorthite could be used for such construction activities in Moon. So we talked about sample return missions. So it involves mining. It involves some other activities. So for all these things, energy will be required. So it is expected that the energy for mining in Moon will be by solar power, because the Moon receives sunlight. And some of the sample return missions are saying that the Moon's soil could be rich in iron, titanium and aluminum, etc. So the Moon mining could actually supply this iron, titanium and aluminum. Moon can be helpful in making propellants. How? They are saying that oxygen can be extracted from the minerals in the Moon, and hydrogen can be extracted from the water deposits on the Moon, and both these can be helpful for making propellants. So today we saw that India is attempting to test deep space technologies by landing in Moon. And Moon could be very useful to learn about long period stay in space. And this will be helpful for planning for other space missions, for other planets. Landing on Moon could teach us how it will be in landing in Mars. Long period stay in Moon could teach us how it will be in Mars. It may guide at least. So this is what they are saying, that the Moon could be very useful to learn about long period stay in space. It may give us some idea about space environment. That is why we are also going to study this year the vertical temperature gradient and other features, thermal conductivity of lunar surface and also seismicity. This has also been planned in Chandrayaan 2 program. So these are all interconnected. So with this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Now, the displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now, let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This article is about the observations made by the Economic Survey about the MG Narega program. The part of the syllabus that can be related to the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. See, in this news article, the authors discuss about a dedicated chapter mentioned in the Economic Survey. This chapter deals with Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. We know that MG Narega provides guaranteed wage employment for at least 100 days in one financial year. This guaranteed wage employment is given to every rural household where the adult members are volunteering to do unskilled manual work. So with this, let's enter into the editorial analysis. See, the Economic Survey has highlighted the benefits of careful and effective targeting of government programs. One such program is NAREGA. The survey highlights the demonstration of
technical interventions adopted for such careful and effective targeting, and the technical interventions adopted for making wage payments. The technical interventions mentioned by the economic survey are the direct benefit transfer and linking of DBT with Aadhaar linked payments, shortly called as ALP. The survey states that the direct benefit transfer enabled in NREGA program has helped to reduce the distress of workers. And it states that after the introduction of direct benefit transfer, the delays in the payment of wages has reduced enormously. Therefore, the scheme is providing livelihood security to people who are in distress. And it also states that because of this, both demand for work and supply of work under this NREGA program has increased, particularly in districts where people are suffering from distress. And it says that the distressed workers are now coming to the unskilled manual work more regularly than before. Then the chapter in the economic survey states that the importance of this Aadhaar linked payments in reducing the distress of people is particularly seen among the vulnerable sections of society, that includes women, persons with disability, persons belonging to the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes. So these are some of the statements made by the economic survey in the particular chapter. Now, based on this chapter, the authors are saying that the chapter has to be properly scrutinized, critically observed, and has to be examined. The authors are of the opinion that the chapter is presenting a skewed or a biased and unbalanced view of the technical interventions. So instead of providing such biased opinion about technical interventions, the chapter should have examined a comprehensive or a complete view on the implementation of the MG NREGA Act. This is what the authors expected from the survey, but instead the survey focused more on technical interventions, that too in a biased manner. It is said that the survey has got majority of points from the working paper of Indian School of Business. And this paper is titled as A Friend Indeed. Does the use of digital identity make welfare programs truly counter-cyclical? But this working paper was disapproved by another research paper that was released in 2018. And this another research paper has highlighted three obvious and clear flaws on the working paper of Indian School of Business. Said that there were factual errors, methodological flaws, and also conceptual flaws in the working paper of Indian School of Business. But even after this, the working paper of Indian School of Business has been accepted without any criticism, and it has been widely cited in the economic survey. Therefore, the authors are raising questions about the credibility of the person under whose guidance the economic survey was compiled. And this person is none other than the Office of Chief Economic Advisor, coming under Ministry of Finance. Then the authors give six reasons why this NREGA presentation given by economic survey is misleading. Firstly, the author notes that the mode of payment of wages is not at all a problem, but there are some other problems in the scheme over the past 8 years. There is lack of adequate financial allocation to this NREGA scheme, and because of this there are pending liabilities in the payment of wages, and also that the scheme gives low wages. So the authors are saying that Aadhaar is just a mode of payment. It is just a pipeline that transfers funds under this NREGA program, and this Aadhaar linked payments in itself has not solved other financial constraints in the scheme. And they are saying if you take last 5 years, every year they will allocate some amount in the union budget for this NREGA program. If you see 20% of the budget allocation for each time in the last 5 years is just for providing pending wage liabilities that are from previous years. And if you take the period 2016-17, the pending liabilities were the worst, because the liabilities were around 35% out of the total allocation for the scheme. That is, it was around some 13,000 crore out of 38,500 crore that was allocated. Now let's come to the low wages. The MG NREGA wages in many states are 40% lower than the Ministry of Labour's national minimum wage. Ministry of Labour and Employment has recommended a national minimum wage of Rs. 375 per day or Rs. 9,750 per month. If you see the NREGA wages in many states, they are 40% less than these amounts. So the authors are criticizing the government because the government, instead of sufficiently funding this NREGA program, the government is concentrating on creating a complex architecture based on technical solutions. We know that the NREGA program or the NREGA MG NREGA Act provides a legal guarantee for wage employment. This legal guarantee is provided by giving allowances and compensation whenever there is a failure to provide work during demand. And allowances and compensations are also given when there are cases of delays in wage payments. So how to solve these problems? The simple answer is the government should have enough funding. That is why the authors are saying that instead of finding technical solutions, the government should have sufficiently funded this MG NREGA program. The second reason is that the economic survey misrepresents the continuous technological interventions made within this NREGA program since the introduction of the program. They are saying that the electronics fund transfer has started in 2011 itself, before 8 years. And it was made through the electronic fund management system that is shortly called as EFMS. Now, this EFMS system is a platform for financial institutions to make electronic payments to workers, staff and vendors using NEFT or RTGS or other systems, etc. So this system that was introduced in 2011 has addressed the issue of delay in payments to a larger extent, and it made management of information system, that is MIS, based on real-time transactions. In 2016, the government introduced the National Electronic Fund Management System called as NEFMS. And it is said that this NEFMS is based on the system that was introduced way back in 2011. So if you see here, we could observe the technological interventions happening way before 2015, since 2011. But if you see the economic survey, it uses the term ALP for Aadhaar linked payments, combines this ALP with direct benefit transfer, and it repeatedly refers to the time before 2015 as pre-direct benefit transfer. So this gives an impression or misrepresentation as if no technological interventions were present before 2015. So in a way, it actually denies the positive effects that different technological interventions had on this NREGA program before 2015. This is what the authors mean when they say the economic survey has misrepresented the technological interventions in the NREGA since it was introduced. Now let's see the third reason. The survey states that timely payments of wages have positively impacted the participation of workers. In order to support this claim, the survey declares that because of introduction of Aadhaar, there is a reduction in payment delays. And this reduction in payment delays, because of introduction of Aadhaar, has increased the participation of workers. So the authors are saying that those who compiled the survey actually have a faulty understanding about the reasons why the payments were delayed. If you have a closer look, the wage payments to NREGA beneficiaries or NREGA workers happen in two stages. The first stage deals with the time taken to generate the electronic funds transfer orders, shortly called as FTO. And once these orders are generated, it will be sent digitally to the central government. The funds transfer order is the equivalence of a pay order in the NEFMS system. So this is the first stage. Now the second stage deals with the time taken by the central government to process these funds transfer orders and to transfer the money to the workers' accounts. The authors are saying delays in the first stage have reduced, but the delays in the second stage, if you see, they are unacceptably high. Only about some 30% of payments are credited to the workers' accounts on time. And it is said that the central government takes more than 50 days to transfer wages to the workers. So the delay is actually in the second stage, where the central government is processing the FTOs to transfer wages to workers' accounts. So this is how the payments are delayed. But if you look at the survey, it only considers the delays in the first stage. And we know that Aadhaar has no role in reducing the delays in the first stage. Because the first stage is just about generating the FTOs. Aadhaar comes to play only in the second stage. Because only in the second stage, the money is credited to the beneficiary's account. Therefore, the authors are criticizing the claim made by the survey that the Aadhaar links payments have positively impacted the flow of payments under the scheme. And therefore, this is just a manipulation of facts by the economic survey. Now let's see the fourth reason why the statements made by economic survey are misleading. The survey credits and praises Aadhaar for the increase in demand for work and the increase in supply of work, particularly in the drought affected areas. The survey has ignored some crucial important factors. For example, it ignores Supreme Court's orders, particularly in the case law of Swaraj Abhiyan versus Union of India. Supreme Court has noted that there cannot be any justifiable reason to delay the payment of wages, or there cannot be any justifiable denial of compensation for delayed payment of wages. And any delay in payment of wages or compensation violates the statutory provisions with respect to NREGA program. So the court stated that in terms of MG NREGA Act and the Schedule 2 of the Act, a worker is entitled to wages to be paid within a fortnight of the date on which the work was done. A fortnight means 14 days or 2 weeks. If the payment is not made within 14 days, then the worker is entitled to compensation as prescribed in paragraph 29 of Schedule 2 of MG NREGA Act. Now, Schedule 2 of this Act actually mentions the conditions for guaranteed rural employment and minimum entitlements of laborers. Here, paragraph 29 relates to wage payment. It states that in cases where wages are not paid within 15 days from the date of closure of muster roll, the wage laborer shall be entitled to receive compensation for the delay. And this compensation is 0.05% of the unpaid wages for every day of delay. Now, when we say muster roll, it is the official list of working men and women under this act. Muster rolls are actually a form of attendance register signed by the workers. It acts as a preliminary check in the sense that if demand and supply of work increases, that will be reflected in the muster rolls. But the same muster rolls is also helpful to identify false reporting of numbers also. Because if there is no change in the muster rolls that are filled, that means there is no increase in demand and supply of work. This means there is a false reporting of numbers in the muster rolls. Then the Supreme Court has actually directed the central government through Ministry of Rural Development to have consultation with state governments and governments of Union Territory and Union Territory administrations to prepare a time-bound mandatory program to make wage payments and compensation to the workers. So based on this Supreme Court's direction, the Ministry of Rural Development issued some directives between 2014 and 2017 to ensure work allocation and on-time payment of wages. We can note that these judicial administrative directives have came into effect after the introduction of Aadhaar. It is these directives that played a very important role in the increase of NREGA work in the drought areas. But the survey does not mention about the intervention role played by the Supreme Court as a contributing factor for the increase in demand of work and the increase in supply of work in the drought affected areas. So the authors say that this casual analysis of the economic survey makes its own findings as unreliable. Now there is another cause why there was increase in demand and supply of work. If you look at the state of Rajasthan, there was a campaign called as Work Demand Campaign that was initiated in December 2018. And this campaign has resulted in around 67% increase in the generation of employment in the state. And they are saying that it resulted in a record number of households completing 100 days of work under this NREGA program. So this is with respect to Rajasthan. If we consider Karnataka, there is a threefold increase in employment generation in 2019 comparing to 2018. So this was because of the demonstration of political and administrative priority to NREGA program that had a strong positive impact on the program. So the authors are saying the increase in demand and supply of work under NREGA has nothing to do with Aadhaar linked payments, because the Aadhaar linked payments have happened way back in 2015 itself. But still the economic survey is clinging to this Aadhaar linking payments as something that has resulted into increase in demand and supply of work in NREGA. Then they are saying the survey has wrongfully attributed the nature of positive targeting to the Aadhaar introduction. They are saying that the program has identified the vulnerable sections, particularly women, the people belonging to scheduled caste and the scheduled tribes. They are the targeted beneficiaries by the act. But effectively targeting these sections was made because of Aadhaar is wrong. This denies the positive impact of universal access of NREGA, because if you see NREGA, there is actually no eligibility criteria other than being an adult who is willing to do unskilled manual labor. Now the problem here is when they say that the positive targeting of NREGA is done only because of Aadhaar, it means that one should have technical knowledge about Aadhaar to be an eligible person to be benefited under the act. These are opinions of the authors. Now let's see the final reason why the economic survey is misleading. The survey claims the Aadhaar link payments eliminates ghost beneficiaries. When we say ghost beneficiaries, we mean fake beneficiaries. That is, without participating in the unskilled manual work, they are getting payments. The authors are saying that this claim is an exaggerated observation, because an RTA query has found out that the ghost beneficiaries accounted for just 1.4% of total households in 2016-17. Again, these are opinions of the authors. So while concluding, the authors quote Melvin Kanzberg, who is a technology historian, who said that technology is neither good nor bad, nor is it neutral. The authors are quoting this because the survey completely ignores numerous instances where technology has resulted in violation of the rights of workers under this NREGA program. So we can see examples where the same technology was not used, when there were delay in payments, when there is no paying of unemployment allowance or no payment of compensation for delay in payments, etc. They also point to one another study by the Indian School of Commerce, but this study is not cited in the economic survey. It shows that around 38% of the Aadhaar based transactions in the state of Jharkhand, these were diverted to a different accounts. Beneficiary is 1%, the person who received the wages were totally another person. This happened to 38% of the workers in the state of Jharkhand. So the economic survey has actually overlooked these fundamental issues and problems. Instead, it has cherry-picked few studies and taken the studies that are most beneficial or profitable and that will not damage the name of the government. So they are saying that such use of flawed analysis to justify technocracy is just an example of ethical paralysis. That is, using such biased analysis to justify the control of society by an elite group of technical expertise is an example of ethical paralysis. Here, when the authors mean elite group of technical expertise, could be actually mean the government or the chief economic advisor's office, under whose guidance the economic survey is actually prepared. So, with this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now, let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is about the declining number of native cattle breeds. The syllabus that can be related to the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. A petition was filed in Supreme Court to restrict the import of exotic bulls to prevent crossbreeding. When we say exotic bulls, we mean foreign bulls. They are saying the cross breeding of Indian variety with the imported variety is leading to depletion of indigenous cows. The petition has also asked for immediate closing of unauthorized slaughterhouses. So overall point is that Indian native cows are decreasing day by day. Their population is in decreasing trend day by day, because of crossbreeding and indiscriminate slaughter. While we have Biological Diversity Act of 2002 and Environment Protection Act of 1986 that aims to protect and conserve biodiversity and environment, the government has actually not taken enough sufficient measures to protect the indigenous cattle population. The news article states that the petitioner was also dissatisfied with the report of National Green Tribunal on the same matter. And we also have a report by Rashtriya Govansh Ayog, which is also called as National Commission on Cattle. And this has expressed very serious concerns with respect to slaughtering of milking cows and calves. It is said that India is having the largest livestock population in the world. And according to 2012 livestock census, the livestock population in India is 51.2 crore. And within this, if you see the proportion of cattle, it is 37.28%. But we should note that India is losing its richness in native breeds. And this is due to rapid crossbreeding with exotic breeds and indiscriminate slaughtering of animals, which is happening for the purpose of export. Now, we know that the domesticated native animals are well adapted to adverse climatic conditions and certain diseases in our country. But they are being gradually replaced by crossbreeds nowadays, and the productivity of crossbreeds actually decreases over a period of time. So we can say due to this genetic dilution, due to this crossbreeding, almost 60 to 80% of Indian livestock now falls under nondescript category. When we say nondescript, we actually mean lack of presence of distinct or individual qualities among the cattle because of crossbreeding. So there is also a belief that the Western breeds are good breeds. But it is said that Indian breeds have adapted to the local conditions over thousands of years, but these native breeds are being neglected. Particularly in the last 3 decades, they are saying that crossbreeding of Indian breeds with highly productive foreign breeds are being promoted to meet the rising demand for animal products. This process resulted into endangering some of the native species. Now let's see few advantages with respect to the native species. See, indigenous breeds adjust productivity to the adverse climatic conditions and also to food availability. And they are also resistant to peculiar diseases that can be found in the region where they have evolved. So they are also disease resistant varieties. But the imported breeds, or in other words they say elite breeds, they are productive only in ideal and disease-free conditions. If you take a longer run, the productivity of exotic species decreases. This means crossbreeding is not a good plan for a longer run. Now, the domestic and wild animals in India are known for their adaptability to hot climate and also their resistance to many diseases. We could find several instances of developed countries coming here and taking samples of the tissues of these animals and also using these animals for crossbreeding. The tissues have been taken for research studies and analysis and also for the study of genes. But there is some belief among the farmers that the native breeds are inferior because of low productivity. Now, the problems with respect to crossbreeding is that it has resulted into loss of local breeds. And even the imported breeds, they were not able to adapt to their new environment. So, over a period of longer period of time, we could see declining performance of crossbreed cattle or imported breeds. When the cattle are being imported or when an exotic species is being imported, the diseases also come along with the same animal. But if you ask whether Indian cattle is resistant to these diseases of another territory, it is said that Indian cattle has less resistance towards the new strains of imported bacteria. This leads to increased cattle deaths because of foot and mouth disease among native breeds in India. So these are some of the issues with respect to crossbreeding. Now let's see some of the conservation measures that can be taken immediately. The conservation of native breeds depends on available number of pure breed females. And it is said that this number is very low in certain breeds, and we could see various reports saying that the varieties of Red Sindhi, Sahiwal and Punganur cattle breeds are facing extinction. Therefore, it is suggested that to set up specialized farms. These specialized farms should be set up in the native tracts or the habitat of a particular cattle breed, and highest quality parents from the variety of native breed should be selected, and this will lead to producing offspring of native breed quality. And here they are suggesting that the government should support the farmers who are taking up these tasks appropriately. And there has to be adequate steps taken for conserving the genetic materials of native breeds, particularly in the form of frozen semen and embryos. And there has to be studies to learn about the breeds and also to identify the genes responsible for heat tolerance, the genes responsible for disease resistance, and the genes responsible for high fertility, and preservation of all these genes has to be immediately carried out. And there is one another proposal about how to classify certain breed as endangered. The proposal states that there should be a higher population limit of around 2000 to 5000 number to treat a particular breed as endangered. That means if the number is to be set as 5000, if a particular breed goes, the total population of a particular breed goes less than 5000, then that becomes endangered. And one rationale behind having high number to classify breeds as endangered is because of the harsh environment conditions and prevalence of diseases, and also illiteracy among the farmers, and also the scattered population of local or native breeds in our country. These are some of the criteria said why there has to be some large number to be designated as to classify the category as endangered. And there has to be systematic breed-wise analysis, which will help to prioritize conservation measures. This will help us to understand which breed has very less population so that adequate conservation measures can be initiated. And they also suggest to improve or empower the landless and marginal farmers, because they constitute around 52% of farming population. And landless and marginal farmers, they own around 67% of livestock population in India. So these are some of the measures for conserving the indigenous cattle breeds. This is with respect to the analysis of this news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. First question: ISRO has proposed joint lunar polar exploration mission with which of the following? So during our analysis, we saw this as Chandrayaan 3 as a program that aims to bring some sample of lunar soil and rock to Earth. And this mission is as of now proposed to be a joint collaboration between Indian Space Research Organization and also Japanese Aerospace Exploration Agency. So the correct answer for this question is option C, JAXA. Now ESA stands for European Space Agency, and CNSA stands for China National Space Administration. And during the analysis, we saw that China is planning its fifth series of Chang'e lunar mission series as a sample return mission that is expected to be launched by the end of this year. This question is with reference to Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. They have given three statements and are asking which of the above statements are incorrect. The first statement: it provides at least 100 days of guaranteed wage employment in a financial year to every rural household whose adult members volunteer to do skilled manual work. So this statement is wrong, because we know that the scheme guarantees wage employment to do unskilled manual work. When we say skilled work, it refers to a work that requires workers to have a certain amount of specialized training or to have a learned skill set to perform a particular work. And when we mean unskilled labor, a person to carry out a particular work, he or she does not require any specialized training or any skill set to perform the task. So the first statement is incorrect. Any answer for this question should have the first statement. So you can easily eliminate option C. Now let's see the second statement. It is saying that it is implemented by Ministry of Labor and Employment. Now when you see the question with reference to Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, just by seeing the word employment, you cannot say this statement is correct, because this scheme is being implemented by Ministry of Rural Development, because it aims to provide guaranteed wage employment to every rural household. So the second statement is also incorrect. So you see the options, which option has two statement one and statement two as incorrect. We can find only one option, option D. So the correct answer for this question is option D, because the question asks which of the above statements are incorrect. Now let's see the third statement. Third statement is telling that the central government is having the power to make rules and to amend this particular scheme that is created under the act. Note that the central government has the powers to make rules and to amend the act and not the scheme. With respect to the scheme, it is the state government that has the powers to make rules and to amend the MG Narega scheme. So the third statement is also incorrect. So the correct answer for this question is option D. Now let's see the mains question. The increase in cross-breeding of Indian cattle with exotic breeds has helped to increase productivity and to meet the rising demand for animal products. But it has led the indigenous breeds to the verge of extinction. What all measures can be taken to conserve the native breeds? Now during our analysis, we saw that the cross-breeding of Indian cattle breeds with foreign breeds and the indiscriminate slaughtering of milking cows and calves are actually two strong reasons why the population of native breeds of Indian cows are in declining trend. And there are reports that some of the native breeds such as Red Sindhi, Sahiwal and Punganur cattle breeds facing extinction. Now let's see some of the measures related to conserving these native breeds. As we saw in the analysis, we can set up some specialized farms with the objective to conserve these breeds and also to increase the number of offsprings of native breeds with highest quality parents. And we should also maintain that these specialized farms has to be preferably made in native tracts or native habitats, because we can see that the native breeds have showed highest productivity in their native habitats only. And then there shall be efforts to conserve the genetic materials of native breeds in the form of frozen semen and embryos. And there has to be sufficient research studies to learn more about the native breeds and also to identify the genes that are responsible for disease resistance, heat tolerance, high fertility and other special factors, and preservation has to be made. And setting up of a higher number, such as some 2000 to 5000 limit, as a limit for classifying a cattle species as endangered. And this classification should take care of the harsh environment conditions and also the illiteracy of farmers and the way the population of local breeds has been scattered in our country. And all these factors have to be looked into while proposing such population limit, so as to treat a particular breed as endangered. And we should not be waiting by declaring as smallest number, say for example 750 or 1000, to declare a particular breed as endangered. And there has to be breed-wise analysis that has to be carried out in a systematic manner. This will help in prioritizing the conservation measures. And we saw that 52% of the farming population are landless and marginal farmers. And landless and marginal farmers own 2/3 of the livestock population in India. So there has to be adequate programs, supporting measures, financial and non-fiscal incentives with respect to empowerment of landless and marginal farmers, particularly those who own livestock population in India. So these are some of the measures that can help conserve the native cattle breeds.
With this, we come to the end of today's analysis. If you like the video, press the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation.